very real day in the life of an aspiring author.
The more I talk about this, the more I sound like an insane person, don't I?
Give your brain a break. It's creating an entire world. A tip on writing detail.
The chaos that is this vlog is honestly the chaos that is my brain.
If you have to listen to the song by Braille,
it's too loud.
Condition your brain into this means writing.
How do you write flirting scenes if you're no good at flirting?
The short and sweet answer is...
Hello fellow YouTubers, I'm Cassandra Joy and welcome to my channel and a day in the life of an aspiring Ohio author. In this video, you're gonna be hanging out with me today. I'm gonna take you to one of my favorite cozy coffee shops. It'll be a great time, but it's not just gonna be you staring at me writing the entire time with aesthetically looking B-roll. It's also gonna include a lot of tips and tricks and things that I've learned throughout years of writing. What I've found works for me as someone who has ADD and is an expert procrastinator and a professional worrier. Writing struggles that I've learned the hard way how to overcome and things I've learned to make the process easier. Starting with figuring out things that distract you. For me, it's having my hair in my face. I love having bangs. I love how they look, and these I've left down, but honestly, halfway through, they're gonna go behind my ear because I cannot stand having any hair in my face. It has to be pulled back, so I've worn my hair in a ponytail. The second thing is wearing something comfortable. Now, for me, I really like feeling good in what I wear, and I've taken a lot of time and effort and pride in picking clothing that makes me feel beautiful but also is comfortable. I've decided to wear a floaty dress for today. This dress kind of checks off all of those distraction boxes. It's not too hot, it's not too cold, so temperature won't be an issue. It's the kind of piece that you can put layers with, so I can put on a jacket or take it off if I need to. It's floaty and comfortable, so I don't have to worry about sitting in one spot and feeling fidgety. The fabric isn't scratchy or distracting. You wouldn't think all of those little things are important, but when you have ADD like I do, you find that distractions come really easy in the form of the most tiny things that you would never expect to be a problem. Depending on the coffee house that I go to, sound can either be a hindrance or a help. So if the coffee shop has really loud music and I know that, I take earphones. If it's the kind of place where the music is really understated and very much in the background, I don't always bother with wearing earphones, but I always take them just in case. That is a little bit of a pet peeve of mine. Coffee shops, if any of you are watching, don't make your music too loud because it's really distracting. And if you have to listen to the song by Braille, it's too loud. The next tip is that I pack unnecessary things. Because inevitably, if I don't pack them, I'll get to the coffee shop and I'll realize, oh man, I forgot that little bit to the charging cord, I forgot this SD card, I forgot a myriad of things that are 9 times out of 10 very essential to a productive work day. I also always make sure to pack this book. It's called For the Wolf by Hannah Witten. Not only is it an excellent read, but it also has the style of writing that I'm using for my Night Sky project, which is the name of the project that I've been working on for years and teasing you about, and I'm in the editing stage right now, or rather the word cutting stage. When you find out the actual title of the book, it'll all make sense, but for now that's what we're calling it. I don't know about you, but certain metals that earrings are made of really bother my ears, so wearing something that I know won't cause me pain is another really great way to omit distraction. Another tip is to make sure you've eaten. This sounds like a really obvious tip, but for me, being ADD, one of the misnomers that people don't know about it is that, yes, you struggle with focusing, but only in subjects that you don't like or understand well. If it's a subject or a project like writing or coloring or drawing or painting or all of those artistic things that I'm naturally good at and love, my attention tunnel visions. It's kind of like wearing those horse blinders. You just have no awareness of anything else outside of the thing you're doing. You're hyper-focused. When that happens to me, time disappears really quickly. And I often realize a couple hours later when I emerge, kind of like surfacing from underwater, that I haven't eaten. So I always try to make sure that I eat something that's full of protein that will keep me full for longer periods of time, just in case I get into one of those hyper-focused modes and completely forget to eat.
last video, which was exploring Ohio's oldest opera house. I noticed a couple things when I was looking at the analytics. One was that you guys viewed it so much that it got pushed to number 2 in my top 10 videos, which is so cool and exciting. Thank you guys so much for that. The second thing I noticed was that the audience retention, which basically means how long your audience watches for, was about 9.5 minutes, which coincidentally was right up to the point where the good stuff started happening. For about 9 minutes, I was getting ready, talking you through the day with a sort of mini get ready with me. I can tell that attention spans are definitely getting shorter for people. I'm definitely the kind of vlogger that likes to make and watch people slowly get ready in the morning. Small town, you gotta wave to people when they walk by. But from that analytic, I can tell that that's not as popular anymore. So for this video, I'll try to be a little quicker with starting, with getting you the information you want that you clicked on the video for, all that kind of thing. So today's kind of an experiment. If it feels like this is a little more fast paced, a little less my usual style, I'm trying something new. My next tip is picking your location. Again, it sounds very obvious, but for me, an environment matters. The most important thing is comfortable seats. The place can have the most beautiful, luscious, delicious coffee in the world. If they have terrible seating, I can't stay there for long periods of time. And by that, I mean purebred. I know, I love, love, love purebred. It's still my favorite coffee of all time, but their seating, not great. It's wrought iron, no comfort at all. Which does not promote sitting there for long periods of time. So for writing days like this where I know I'm gonna be there a long time, I tend to lean toward the place that has the coziest aesthetic and the comfiest chairs. Coffee is secondary to comfort for long days like this. So I've decided to go to Grounds for Pleasure in Tipp City, Ohio. It's a very cool coffee shop. It's got strings of Edison bulbs, cozy seats, a nice aesthetic, low lighting, music that isn't too loud. It just checks off all the boxes for settling in for a long editing session. So that's where we're gonna go. They also have a peach smoothie that is quite delicious, and I'm thinking because it's such a hot day, I might get that instead of coffee. I know, shocker, who am I? Next tip, wear comfortable shoes because you never know how far you'll have to walk when you live in a small town and there's limited parking.
To get 2 drinks, 1 coffee, my usual iced mocha latte because it's so warm out. I decided to get a peach smoothie because that just sounded really yummy. Taste test. So as I'm writing, I'll be pulling questions from Instagram from you guys. I figured asking you what you wanted to know would make it easier for me to format what to say. So one of the first questions was, what's my process? How do I start? Do I start at the beginning? Do I start at the end? Work my way backwards? What do? I usually start either at the beginning with the first few chapters, or I write the good parts first. Scenes that are most satisfying, the ones that I'm most inspired to write. At the beginning, I don't worry about filling all the plot holes that I haven't thought of yet. I just write what I'm inspired to write, because if I wait until I have it all figured out, you just lose some of the magic. It also makes a difference if you are a plotter
or a pantser. A plotter is the kind of person who has to have an entire map of everything that they're doing, everything that they're planning. A pantser is someone who sort of thinks on the fly and feels it out as they go. I am 100% a feel it out as I go kind of person. My Night Sky project, that book actually started with an off-the-cuff story I made up on a boat one summer when my little cousins asked me to tell them a story, and they liked it so much, the story progressed for hours, by the way, that I decided to make it a short story. I quickly realized that I'm incapable of writing short stories, and so here we are. For that book, I started with the first few chapters, continued to write the good parts, you know, the battle scenes, or the love interests, or the cute moments. Those were the scenes I wrote first. After writing all of those, and I had run out of the good scenes, I had to stop and be like, okay, now I have to actually plan how to connect all of these. Kind of like a connect the dot game, only not as fun. That is the drawback of being a pantser, because you don't plan out how everything's gonna connect. You just assume that it will. And for me, thankfully, it worked. The benefit of being a plotter is that you already have it all planned out. You don't have to worry about bridging those gaps later on. I don't write in sequence. I write all over the place. And there's no right or wrong way to do it either. Would definitely advise to write what you're inspired to write, because that's where the magic is. When you're uninspired, you can still write, but it's just not the same. It doesn't transfer that fairy dust onto the script, you know? So that's kind of my process. It's important to get your brain engaged in the task of writing. For me, that means creating a ritual. The instant I enter a coffee shop, my brain has been conditioned to think, ooh, okay, we're writing today, we're editing, we're doing authory stuff. So whatever ritual you have, whether it's lighting a candle or putting on a specific background sound, whatever you have to do to condition your brain into that routine of this means writing. I found that to help me a lot, particularly with writer's block. About having an incomplete picture and not knowing all the details right off the bat when you're first starting to write is the creative perfectionist in you wants to have it all right the first go, and that just doesn't always happen. With my Chai project, I've done a first draft of the first 4 or 5 chapters, just written it out, gotten it off my mind and onto a document. I don't have all the details written in. I have a she said, as opposed to she tucked a strand of hair behind her ear and said. Those details can be added in later. Letting yourself get stuck in the sludge of imperfection is what makes your book never get finished. Get it out first. Worry about the details later. Believable character. Writing a character involves getting to know them as if they were a friend. You learn their likes, their dislikes, their strengths, their weaknesses. Having characters have flaws is vitally important to believability. No one wants to read a perfect character, even if they're the good guy. Sometimes you get to know them as you continue writing. For my Chai project, I don't know these characters intimately well yet, but I'm learning as I go. I hesitate to say this because it does make me sound like an insane person, but when you have been writing as long as I have, your characters kind of talk to you. They kind of get their own voices and start having opinions and help you write the plot. Again, this makes me sound insane. But when you get to know your characters as well as you do a friend, they become real. Real as in believability. And that just makes it so much easier to write them. For my Night Sky project, I've lived with my characters for over a decade. A very, very long time. Not quite 2 decades. We're not there yet. But I've known them a long time. So if you were to ask me, what would this character do in this situation? I'd be able to tell you without hesitation because I know them that well. Most of the time, people don't spend as long on their books writing them as I have. I think a lot of authors churn out easy to read books and don't get that depth. Characters feel like a coloring page that only has the first three colors of the rainbow. Without any shadows or highlights, there's no depth, the characters feel flat. That's how my chai project feels right now. They don't feel fully formed yet. And that just comes with time, which I know is not a very helpful answer. You have to live with your characters a while in order to get to know them, just like you would a friend. A tip on writing detail. A lot of people are great at writing dialogue. You use it all the time. You don't often sit down and describe a thing and try to get your reader to see what you're seeing in your head. Fall back on the senses. What can you hear? How does it feel? So for instance, an example. Okay, this is a paragraph from my chai project. I'm describing the character going into the kitchen and getting a cup of coffee. That could be a very boring sentence, just writing it out. So-and-so went into the kitchen and poured a cup of coffee. That's not very engaging, is it? Instead, I wrote, the house seemed to sigh in pleasure as the sunrise filtered through the windows of the kitchen, reflecting off the stained glass above the sink, fracturing into little rainbows over the floor and fridge. She grabbed fresh grounds from the freezer and poured the contents into the coffee maker. The sound like music, the smell like heaven. Doesn't that paint a much more vivid picture than she walked into the kitchen and poured a cup of coffee? Another tip is make it make sense. For instance, with my chai project, I have a guy who doesn't have a problem with people who are a larger size. I couldn't just make him that way with no explanation. He couldn't just be a nice guy who didn't mind someone's size. There had to be a backstory, there had to be a reason, it had to make sense. So that's one tip that I would give, is when you're writing a character, who they are has to make sense based on what they've been through, what their past looks like, what have they gone through to make them the person they are when you meet them in the book. All of that matters. I know it feels exhausting to come up with a backstory for every single character that you come up with, but it's one of the only ways that they will feel real and believable to your reader.
So here's a prime example of not having all the details figured out, but getting it out of your head. I'm blocking half of it so you can't read everything, but as you can tell, I just have a paragraph of dialogue, back and forth, no descriptions, just the two people talking. Because I don't know the setting yet, I don't know where it's taking place in the plot, I don't know where the characters are in reference to this conversation, but I needed to write down the conversation. So having incomplete thoughts is okay. Just get it down, save it for later, and you'll come back to it.
The short and sweet answer is write how you would want to be flirted with. So for me, I grew up in a very sarcastic home. We are very teasing and joking and make fun of each other a lot, in the nicest way, not in a tear-down way. And to me, that would be the most fun way to be flirted with. So a lot of my writing has very sarcastic interactions, dialogue. One of them puts their foot in their mouth and the other doesn't let it go, and it's just very cute and funny, and that's kind of how I've handled it. And when you watch enough romantic comedies, you watch enough TV shows that involve kind of dialogue interactions, you just learn how to make it flow and how to make it funny, because I would be the first to tell you that I cannot flirt. Well, I can flirt, I can't flirt well. I'm able to write really cute scenes between couples that are flirty. So there is a way to do it, and you don't have to be good at it yourself in order to make it good on a page. Okay, I've been working on my chai project for
a few hours now, and I'm now at a part where I'm stuck. But I'm not gonna force it. I'm gonna take a break. I've been working on it a while. I'm gonna shift gears and start working on cutting down the word count of my night sky project. This place closes at 6 p.m., I think, and it's 4 o'clock now, so that gives me a few hours to cut away a few words, hopefully a few thousand words. But that's another tip. If you get to a part where you're just kind of stuck and you can't tell where the plot's supposed to go or how to bridge the gap between one scene and the next, don't worry about it. Give your brain a break. It's working hard creating an entire world. It takes a lot of brain power. Leave it for a while, maybe for a few days or even a week. Come back to it later or pick up another project. It'll all work out. But definitely take breaks. Has my necklace been like this the whole time? That's nice. I'm very happy with the progress of the Chai project though. I've got some really cute moments that I've put down, some really fun dialogue, the characters are building relationships, I'm starting to get to know the characters a little better. It's not fully fleshed out. There's a little shading in there, a little bit of depth starting to come through. So for Project Night Sky, I am just trying to get rid of as many words that are unnecessary as possible. It's as hard as it sounds. Especially when I've lived with this story for so long. It's gone through so many revisions, which is why I'm trying to keep it to the same writing style as this book here. This book is wonderful for many reasons, but one of the things I love about it is that it gets its point across by saying as little as possible. The process of cutting down words isn't hard, it's just time consuming. When you're a writer, you feel like you have to provide everything, right? It's all in your head, you can picture it clearly, and you want the reader to picture it with the same clarity as you do. But in fact, you don't need to because their brains will fill in the gaps. Okay, here's an example of how you can say the same thing with fewer words. The sentence is, her health took a turn for the worse. Instead of saying that, I can say, her health rapidly declined. It's less words, but it says the same thing. Just finished chapter 21. I got one chapter finished. Like I said, it's not hard work, it's just time-consuming work and far less fun than writing. But I did manage to cut over 600 words from that one chapter alone, so I feel very happy with what I was able to accomplish. I'd love if this process was faster, but you have to rethink every single sentence. You have to restructure every single sentence to make it shorter, more concise, tighter, to flow more smoothly. There's no shortcuts. There's no easy way to do this. It's just one of those problems you have to face when you're an overwriter like I am. I have officially closed the place down, so I'm gonna pack up and chat to you when I get to the car. It's golden hour right now. Beautiful weather. Things are starting to cool down in the evenings just a little. I feel like this vlog was probably very chaotic and a little unorganized, but honestly, that's kind of how writing is. I would love to do more topic-themed videos for writing, like how do you write a villain, or how do you make a relationship between two characters grow organically and believably. You guys can let me know in the comments if that would be interesting to you or helpful, but I love writing. I've been doing it all my life. Most of the things I've written are too cringy to ever show, but Project Night Sky and Project Chai are definitely two things I'm very proud of, and I like sharing bits and pieces with you. Back to my car. It's probably gonna be boiling. The joy of having leather seats.
I wish I could walk through.
My advice if you're just starting out writing, just write. Write for the joy of it. Don't worry about getting it published. Don't worry about having an editor look at it. Just write.
let it be imperfect. You can always go back and add details later. You can always go back and tweak it. Sometimes you'll start writing a story and it just doesn't work. I've had quite a few stories go that way. Advice I was told when I did songwriting: some songs are meant for the radio and other songs are the bridge that will get you to the place to write the songs that will be on the radio. And I thought that was such a cool way to look at it. With that perspective, it doesn't feel like a waste. It doesn't feel like you failed. It's not a fail. It's just a bridge to get you to that better thing. I hope you guys have enjoyed hanging out with me today in this very real day in the life of an aspiring author. If it felt chaotic, that's because it is. I wish I could pretend that it was this perfectly organized aesthetic experience, and sometimes it can be, but most of the time it's not. The chaos that is this vlog is honestly the chaos that is my brain. My brain is full of characters, worlds, cities, continents, creatures, magic, monsters, villains, motives, backstories, history, plot. My brain is very full of details and voices. The more I talk about this, the more I sound like an insane person, don't I? Writing is so fun. I love it. I wouldn't change the chaos for a second of perfection. I don't know if my books will ever make it onto bookshelves, but I'm writing them and working on them as if they will. If you have specific questions that I didn't touch on in this vlog, please comment them down below and I'll make a secondary video answering those questions. I'm of the opinion that experience needs to be shared. I've met quite a few people, specifically in the music industry, who like to keep what they've learned close to their chest as if sharing it might deter their own success. I believe that knowledge is meant to be shared. If I can help any of you with your writing, whether it's book writing or songwriting or just life advice in general, I want to share it. Speaking of that, I'm planning on filming 33 life lessons I've learned in 33 years. Because again, advice is often earned the hard way. And if I can help somebody not have to learn it the hard way, I want to. So yeah, leave all your questions in the comments. Thank you for coming along with me on this day in the life. I hope you enjoyed. Please don't forget to subscribe and hit that notification bell so that you never miss a future video from me. I upload on Wednesdays and Saturdays, both at 6 a.m. I would love for you to be part of this little online family. Thanks so much for watching, and I'll see you in the next one. Love you guys. Mwah. Bye.